Окей, за сайн байна уу манай. MetaStory
Filmmaking
сургалтын 2 дугаар өдрийн найруулгын хичээл маань ингэж
эхэлж байна. Back everybody.
Our Mr. Lee Michael Khan, our teacher from Los Angeles Film School is ready. Hello, Mr. Khan.
Hi.
Good evening.
Good. Can you see the directing slide?
Yeah, we can see you. But with the sound, let me fix the sound real quick. Mr. Khan, can you say something to us?
Yes. Hi. Hello, future filmmakers.
Okay.
Hello, everybody.
So we have another technical difficulty on the phone. I mean, audio.
I'm here. I'm standing by.
Okay. Thank you for that.
Sure. No problem.
Okay.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello, Mr. Khan. Please speak.
Yeah. Hi, I'm right here. I'm sitting here in Los Angeles, and you are in Mongolia.
Yeah, sorry.
That's okay. Shall I keep speaking? Can you hear me?
Sorry. So apparently the organizing party has changed their settings overnight, last night. So that has caused us some problem, but we'll fix it right now.
Okay, don't worry. I'm here.
Hello?
Yes, right here. I'm here. Yeah.
Don't let her leave just because John's parked away from the door. So if she goes to leave, the garage door goes.
Where's John? He can come in. Where's John?
He's just doing some stuff in the car. I wanted to come in.
He's down in the.
Yeah.
Okay.
Ача. Агугу. Контроль зум тийш. Майк энэ талан да.
Hello, hello.
Hello, I can hear you.
Hello, this is Nato speaking. Hello.
Hi, Nato. I can hear you. I'm going to text you once.
Speak to us, please.
Oh, Devon.
Hello. Hi. You should be fine now.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Oh, okay. Success.
Yay. All right. Okay.
Sorry about that.
No problem. No problem.
Let me turn the volume a bit. All right. We are still live.
Let's go. And you see the first slide directing basic coverage? What are you looking at? Do you see the slide?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
Directing basic coverage?
Okay, good. You can see. Yeah, great. Okay, so first of all, I thought you all did a real good job on your stories. I think that they're, you know, you did a lot of very good work in a very short period of time. And if we have some time, we can, excuse me, we can go over them a bit. But today, we're going to change our focus a little bit, obviously, to directing. And I will say to start with that, you know, there's never been a good film, or certainly not a great film, without a great script. So everything the director does has one basic purpose, and that is to tell the story as best he can. Everything that a director chooses, from the camera angles to the casting to the way he edits the film, is all has that same basic idea in mind. How can we tell the story to the audience in the simplest, most emotional way? Okay? So you always refer, when you're making choices as a director, to the story, because that's ultimately what really counts, and that's what an audience is going to come out of the movie remembering. Okay, so we're going to talk today about what we call directing coverage. Now, coverage is a term used in movies that means to make sure that you've gotten all the camera angles that you need to edit the film together in post-production. Okay, so it really... Yeah.
Sorry, Mr. Khan. Let me just, I think somebody had a question about the word coverage. Let me just explain it real quick. Coverage гэдэг юм хэд одоо ингэ юм хэд нэг одоо яг хамруулаад нэг үзэх хэрэг хэлж яах вэ? Нэг сэдвийг юм хэд нэг хамруулна гэсэн үг.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. The term means literally that we're going to cover the entire scene. We're going to make sure that the entire scene has been filmed, so we can edit it together later, okay? And that's the term that we use in filmmaking, is called coverage, okay? Generally speaking, what you do is you start with a wide shot, and that's called your master. We're going to go over this, you know, in detail. And then once you've shot your master, you know where you need your closer shots. So you start wide, and then you move into the scene for coverage, okay? So... first thing we're going to talk about is just this is basic framing, okay? And we call this the rule of thirds.
Sorry, Mr. Khan, just one more clarification. Coverage is you in Bishop. No, still I put a harrow on Bishop. Filmmaking that he used to do. The Yunki Yamarning is still a harrow on the Hilt Homer Harrowstop. I don't know the technician to do to the group is ready to get to.
Okay. 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 Yeah, feel free to jump in whenever you need to. Okay, so if you look at this drawing, you'll see that there's nine boxes. And if you look where the crosses are, those are the strongest points in a frame. The points where those boxes intersect are where you want to put the major elements of your composition. Okay, so... that's a scene from Raging Bull. If you look at the boxing gloves, the two on the bottom of the frame, and you look at the boxing glove, the upper left, and then you look at Robert De Niro's face, you can see where the boxing glove at the top is hitting the other boxer. It's all where the thirds are. Okay? Now, not every composition has to have an element in all four of those spots, but those are the strongest visual points in a cinema frame, okay? And we call that the rule of thirds. So when you're framing, you're trying to put your most important elements in the shot into those positions. Okay? Now, here we have, this is from There Will Be Blood, and that's Daniel Day-Lewis, and if you look where his head is positioned, okay, that is right in one of the thirds. Okay? Again, if we go back, and then we go forward, you can see his head is in the upper left third. Also, all of that emptiness is what we call, in a movie frame, we call that negative space. Okay? Negative space, which basically means a space where there is no, there's no character. It means it's open space. Sometimes in a frame like this, in a shot like this, the negative space is very effective, okay? Because it gives the character a sense of loneliness and a sense of isolation. So it's very good visually. Sometimes filmmakers make a mistake. Let's say that Daniel Day-Lewis, let's imagine his chair was all the way to the left, all the way to the edge of the frame, okay? And let's imagine he was talking to somebody else and their chair was all the way to the right. So what dominates the frame is not the characters, but the big blue sky in between them. So that would be a use of negative space that would be not good. In this, because he's framed properly, because the character is put in a powerful position in the frame, the negative space works very powerfully to give a sense of loneliness and a sense of him being isolated. Okay? Okay. This is from the David Lynch movie, Blue Velvet. And again, if you look at where the mask is, and you look at where the bottom of her face is in his hand, we are approximately in the thirds, okay? Even though this is obviously a very different composition than that, a very different composition, the key elements in these frames are placed in those positions, okay? When you are framing a shot, you want to look to have what we call the proper amount of headroom, okay? Which means the distance from the top of the frame to the top of the actor's head. The larger the shot, the wider the shot, the more headroom generally a character has. And you have less and less headroom as you move closer and closer. Okay? This is a medium close-up. Excuse me. And you'll notice that she still has a little bit of room at the top of the of her head. But it's much less. Okay, this is probably just the way the photo rendered. This is not actually the way that it looks in the film. But as I'll point out later, this is actually improperly framed because it's cutting him off right at the hairline. Okay, and that doesn't look natural. Okay, this is more of an extreme close-up. And as we look at close-ups, you'll see that we're sort of begin to center more and more in the eyes. So when you start to get really tight like this, it's okay to begin to cut off the top of the head. Okay. Now this is from Citizen Kane, and what you have here is a very, at least at the time, this was a very unusual composition because we have the character of the woman very small, and she's very, very low in the frame. And what that's by design because it gives the impression of her being very small and very powerless and very insignificant. And it makes the space, the architecture of the room, very large and very, in a way, intimidating or scary. Okay? So by giving her all that headroom and placing the camera so she's very low in the frame, it gives a diminishing effect on the character. Okay? Another thing that's important about framing is what we call leading your subject, okay? And this is especially important when you have a moving camera. If you notice the monks, they're moving screen left to screen right. And you'll notice that there's a big space. Yes, it's negative space, but it's by design. There's a big space between the monk in the front and all the way to the end of the frame. You have to leave room for the characters to move into, okay? It looks more natural, and it gives the audience the impression that there is space beyond the frame. Okay, so whether this was a still shot, right, where the camera's not moving but the monks are moving, or if the camera's panning, which is, means it's moving with the characters, you want to leave room for your subjects. Okay, in a close-up, we call this looking room. Okay, if you, this is from Apocalypse Now, if you notice, Robert Duvall is looking off into the distance, but he's framed so there's enough space to the left of him where we get the impression that he's talking to somebody off camera, and we get the impression that the space expands beyond the frame, so it feels more natural. Okay? Now, this is correct framing. If you're trying to lead your subject correctly, this would be incorrect, okay, to put the character at the edge of the frame there. This is not from a movie. This is from the Los Angeles Film School. Yes, that's. I think it's one of our former students who we made a very famous model now.
Okay.
I will talk to you. This is what we call an unbalanced frame, and I will talk to you a little later about when you would choose to have a frame like this, okay? But the correct way, again, is to leave your character what we call looking room, right? Well, let me explain this really quick. By not leading your subject, hold on a second.
American History X, this one. You do the last thing in the Torgum or getting a tiger or such as after that. Би сайнхыг барыг нөгөө full metal jacket гэх кино үзсэн. Тэр кино нэг мэсгэсэн байх гэж байсан. Чинь баг ихний юм байсан.
Okay, I'm sorry about that. Okay, so what we see here, when you don't lead your subject, right? That's correct. When you don't lead your subject, what it does is it gives a sense of a character being trapped, right? Being isolated. This is from American History X. And even though the character is in an open space, there's room behind him, to the right of him. If we look at to the left of the frame, where it's very closed off, it does give a feeling, again, of being alone or being isolated. Okay? That's from that's Roman Polanski in a movie called The Tenant, and he's doing the same thing, but he's doing it in a close-up. Okay? There's very little looking room to the right, and that closes in the character. It makes it more... You know what I mean by claustrophobic? Like the space is closing in around the character, okay? Okay, the other important thing to make a decision about when you're figuring out how to shoot a character is what we call the sight line, okay? The way that an audience connects to a character emotionally is through the eyes, okay? That's how human beings connect with each other. And instinctively, an audience will gravitate, when they're looking at a character on the screen, will gravitate toward that character's eyes. So the amount of exposure that you give a character's eyes, in other words, excuse me 1 second.
Okay. Okay. Танах ч нөгөө бас нэг давчуу мавчуугаа ямар санаа байлаа. Cursed One гэд хараад харагдсан юм. Тэр мэр чинь бас юм нөгөө жоохон нүд надад зүүн тийш харсан дүрмийн манд дүрийнхаа
дүнлээ. Okay, sorry about that. Anyway, so you'll see what I mean when I show you these stills, right? If a character's eyes are exposed to the camera, okay? And a lot of lighting actually goes around making sure that the eyes are clear to the audience, if that's your intent. The amount that the eyes are open and exposed to the audience is the amount that the audience feels connected to the character. Okay? So this is from Casablanca. And in this scene, this is an interesting framing, because one eye is open to the audience, but his left eye is kind of half obscured, and So we kind of can connect to him as a character, but there's a little bit that's hidden. There's a little bit of a sense of mystery. There's a little bit of a sense of, you know, him being a little disconnected from us, okay? Now, obviously, that's by design, right? You don't always have to have your character's eyes very connected to the audience. Sometimes you might want to create some mystery or create some fear in the audience sometimes. So you would hide their eyes, okay? I'm going through this a little bit quickly. In another presentation that I do, we go over sightline in great detail and I show you some clips. So this is Ingrid Bergman, also from Casablanca, and you see that she's very, her eyes are very open and very exposed, okay? And actually you can see the way it's lit. There's literally a bit of shine in her eyes, okay? Also, she happens to be a great actress. She was a great actress and a beautiful woman, so it's very easy to look at her. But we are drawn into her eyes because they are open to us emotionally, okay? Whereas with Rick, it's not quite the same, okay? This is a Merchant Ivory film. This is an example of a character that we don't see the eyes, right? We're made to wonder about her a little bit. We don't know exactly what she's thinking. And again, it gives the appearance of loneliness. It gives the appearance of isolation, okay? Also, she's framed by the smoke. And her glasses are over her eyes, so we really don't connect to her eyes at all, okay? And I want to stress, by the way, that none of this is right or wrong or better or worse. It is a choice that you make when you set up a shot, how much you want to expose the character emotionally to the audience, okay? Okay, so... Are there any questions about that material? Does that make sense, everybody? I can go back to one of the frames if anyone wants to look again.
I think we're good.
Okay, terrific.
Sorry, one more question.
Oh, sure.
So she's asking if you could name all the shots, like extreme shot, full shot, close shot.
That's what we're going to do right now. Okay, we're going to go through. We're going to just 1 second, everybody. I'll be right back. Sorry.
No problem. Yes, in the Facebook today.
We're now going to go through the entire basic vocabulary of shot sizes, okay? So I want you to think about it this way. What we just looked at up till now have been what we would call issues of composition, right? Where to place elements in a frame, right? Proper spacing, these kinds of things. So now we're going to look at what we would call shot size, okay? So the first thing we'll look at is what we call the full shot, okay? And it typically will show the entire object or human figure from head to toe. We also sometimes call this the long shot. Now, if you look, you'll notice there is both headroom and room at the bottom of the frame, okay? The purpose of this shot, and it's usually, again, I also want to say that, you know, these are just some basic rules. There are many, many examples of films and scenes that change them, okay? But I think it's important to understand the basics of film vocabulary, and then you can make the choices that you want with them, okay? But generally speaking, the purpose of a full shot or a long shot is to give the audience a sense of the geography of the scene. Where are they? Okay, and where are our characters in space, both in relation to each other and in relation to their environment? Okay, now what's interesting about the way an audience's mind works is once you show an audience the geography, once you give them a full shot, it's like their brain is a computer, and they put it into their computer and it's there. Okay, So once you've established the geography of the space, you are really free to then go into closer shots. You don't have to stay in a full shot forever, okay? But generally speaking, we also sometimes call this the establishing shot, right? We establish the geography and we establish the character's physical relationship, okay? I've been trying to figure out what movie this is from. I will look it up.
No. So actually, we have an answer. Go ahead.
Yeah?
So the day the Earth stood still turned out.
Oh, the science fiction movie. Okay. Yeah. I have no reason.
Actually,
to...
all of the stills that follows.
Yeah.
I put them up. I uploaded them on Facebook yesterday.
Oh, great.
And, like, I think every single one of them were named. I think like these people have watched more films than I ever could. So they're the experts here.
I you can
ask what film is it from, and they'll give you the answer.
Well, that's great. So when I come to Mongolia, we'll have a film festival. So what you see here, this is what we also call a deep focus shot, because the background goes back quite a ways in the frame, and it's shot with a lens. It's probably a 25 or 35 millimeter lens that's going to keep the entire frame in focus. Okay. So obviously this character is lit in a dark in an underlit way on purpose. It gives an air of mystery and all that, but we see his entire figure from head to toe and we get a sense of the place. Okay? This is a very interesting shot as well. This is from the movie Patton. It's one of the great openings in movies, and actually the first thing we see is what's got to be the biggest American flag ever, which is at the back of an auditorium, and we see the stage, and then we see Patton come up from the rear to the stage and stand in front of this flag, and then they go in a bit closer, okay? So it's very much a stab. Remember we talked yesterday about the opening shot establishing the theme and establishing a bit about the character. So this establishes a lot of things about Patton. It establishes his patriotism. It establishes, and also in they play a call to attention, a military call to attention, and he stands, you know, saluting. And while this bugle is playing, they do close-ups of all his medals and all that stuff. So we see right away in the long shot first, and then in the smaller shots that this is a very decorated soldier and very patriotic and all that. But basically, he's literally engulfed in the American flag, which is a very powerful image. Okay, this is from Rocky, the movie we talked about way too much, and I won't talk about it anymore. but the environment here is very important. First of all, this is the montage where at the beginning, or he couldn't run up the stairs, and he wasn't in shape, and then now he's up the stairs and he's triumphant. So the environment, including the environment here, not only is it a pretty shot because you have the sun breaking, you know, you have the color, especially on the left of the frame, but you also have a sense of him being kind of on top of the world, you know. He's up, and that's his Philadelphia, the city of Philadelphia, that's his world, that's his universe, right? And it literally tells us he's feeling triumphant, he's feeling, you know, on top of it, okay? So again, this is an example of a long shot that's very effective in evoking an emotion in the audience, okay? The next shot we call a cowboy. And I want to point out a couple things about this. Nobody I know in an American film has ever on sets called it an American shot. We refer to it as a cowboy, okay? And what a cowboy does is it's framed from the top of the head. And if you notice, right, there's still lots of room. If you had him cut off where he is, more or less, but then you cut off the top of his head, it would look very odd. It would look very unnatural. So it's generally, in a cowboy, it's the top of the head, and you leave room to the top of the frame, and then it's just above or just below the knees. Now, I want to point out something about this drawing. This drawing is actually showing a mistake. If you look at the bottom of the frame is literally cutting off the figure at the knees, okay?
You never want to do that. You never want to cut off a frame on a person at the joints. You never want to cut them off at the neck. You never want to cut them off at the elbows. You never want to cut them off at the waist. You never want to cut them off at the knees, okay? Because it looks like they were in a box and a magician sawed them in half, you know? It looks like their body has been severed, and it looks a bit strange and unnatural. So you always try to frame it in a cowboy above or below the knee, all right? And you'll also see just from the drawing that we're still including a fair amount of the environment, okay? There, I'm sure we all know who that is. Hello, Clarice.
Right.
This actually, if I remember the shot, they actually start and they dolly in on him, and then they come to rest there. So getting his full figure, getting his physique, getting him standing there, and seeing the environment that Hannibal Lecter lives in, this little cell, you know, it's got almost nothing in it, is important because it tells us we need to understand his physical world. We need to understand, especially for later in the film, how somebody could be so powerful and affect so many people from inside a cell, from inside a prison cell, okay? So this is a cowboy that's framed a little low because it's basically, if you look at where the shot is cut off at the bottom of the frame, it's between the knees and the ankle, okay? This is from Brokeback Mountain. This is a little joke. This is a cowboy of a cowboy. this is framed up a little bit higher, okay? Also, we'll talk about the angling a little bit. But if you notice, it's just below the knees. It's perfectly framed. You can see at the bottom of the frame how the material in his jeans is a little bit wrinkled, right? That's, you know, what pants do sometimes at the knee, and they've gone just below it. If it was framed up another couple of inches and was directly across the knee, again, it would look strange. Also, this is in a cowboy shot. Generally speaking, you're framing it this way because for some reason the physical environment is important, right? In this case, it's the fireworks going off, and then he's looking across the way at his, you know, secret lover, at Jake Gyllenhaal, right? So that information is important to the audience. The environment, the space is important, okay? This is also a cowboy of samurai. It's from the movie The Last Samurai. We'll talk a little bit more about this as well. This also utilizes something we call a frame within a frame, which is, if you look, the way that the guys are standing in the doorways frame them. It pops them out from the background, okay, and it gives them more a presence in the shot, okay? All right? So now we're moving in a bit, and we come to the medium shot, okay? It's typically framed just below the waist, and if you look at this drawing is accurate. If you look at his waist, which would be where his pants meets his shirt, okay, it's framed just below. If we were to frame it right where the shirt meets the pants, again, it's going to look like someone cut off the bottom of his body, okay? Now, the important thing about the medium shot is that it's the most commonly used frame size in cinema. Not the long shot, not the wide shot, the medium shot, okay? For common action, okay, and basic dialogue, the medium shot is the most common shot. Okay, we'll talk about over the shoulders and close-ups in a bit, okay? But what this does, you have to remember, guys, that as you move closer and closer with the camera, right, it's almost like a funnel, a reverse funnel, going straight to the character's eyes, right? The orientation of the human figure in terms of framing in cinema is the eyes. So the medium shot allows the actor to have gestures and some body movement, but it's becoming more intimate, okay? That really is the key concept here. The closer you get to the subject's face, the more intimate the experience is for the audience, okay? Now, what you want to do, what you want to think about, and we'll look at, hopefully we'll have an example or two that we'll play. There are some scenes that are shot almost entirely in close-up, right? Ingmar Bergman is somebody who does this a lot. A lot of times he'll have scenes that are so emotional, that are, the characters are in so much, you know, heightened emotion that he wants to grab the audience and not let go, okay? And this can work, okay? It tends to work in tight spaces. But what the other way to think about it is that a director will wait to cut to the close-up until the most emotional moments in the scene, right? You work your way generally to your close-up shot, right? And then when you do cut to that close-up, it's going to have impact. It's going to land because you've now made the audience more intimate with the character at their most emotional moments, all right? Which is why, again, not the wide shot, because the wide shot, you know, the characters are maybe a little bit lost in the frame. It's about establishing geography. Not the close-up or the tight close-up, which we tend to hold on to until the scene gets more intense. But the medium shot is the one we use the most for commonly staged action in cinema. Okay? Does that make sense? I don't have a question about that.
Sure. I just wanted to comment. No, hilgu humus no harnda hilgdish de. Тэгэхээр нөгөө body language gesture гэдэг нь medium shot хамгийн юу юм штэ. Тэгэхээр танаа санаан дээр очсон хэрэг орж байгаа.
Okay. Okay. There he is.
Hello? Mr. Khan, are you there?
I'll see him.
Oh, okay.
Mr.
Khan, I think we had a line breakup again. Could you repeat your last sentence?
Sure. This is Bruce Lee, great Bruce Lee, and it's from, it's not Enter the Dragon. I'll find the title here. But it's the big fight that takes place in the Roman Colosseum where he fights Chuck Norris, the great American karate champion Chuck Norris, also the hairiest martial artist ever in the history of the world. What's interesting about this, I love the way this whole sequence is shot and the way this whole sequence is edited because they are extremely smart about the way they cut back and forth between wides and close-ups, okay? There are times where, it's the Chinese Connection. I believe it's the Chinese, is it Chinese Connection?
We don't know?
Yeah, hang on, I'll tell you which movie, just give me a sec.
Name of the movie. You know what movie is? Fisherman. Fisherman, right? Chinese Connection, you just don't know.
Is it Chinese Connection? That's what I thought. No. You know what it is? It's Way of the Dragon. It's not Chinese Connection. It's Way of the Dragon. It's called Way of the Dragon. Okay. I know it's confusing because almost every Bruce Lee movie has the word dragon in it. You know. and his nickname was Little Dragon. What's important about this shot is that it's a medium because his body position, he's still in the fight. What's actually happening is he's knocked Chuck Norris down. Chuck Norris is on the ground. And you can see, if you look at his eye line, he's looking down, right? And what he actually is going to do, they're going to cut in a little bit to a close-up of him where he just shakes his head no. Right, he just shakes his head at Chuck Norris, saying, "Don't get up, right? Because if you do, it's not going to be so good for you, right?" But at this moment, the fight is still on, so we need both the physical tension. We need his body. We need to see his fighting posture. We need to see his musculature. But at the same time, we need to be close enough to connect to him in his emotions, because what he's thinking, right? Because he's wondering, is he going to get up? Am I going to have to kill him? So there's a lot going on in this fight in terms of the emotion of it, all right? So that's why a director at this moment would choose a medium, because you need both the physical and the emotional working together. And we're close enough to Bruce where we can feel what he's feeling and we can kind of guess what he's thinking, okay? That's Gary Oldman from a movie called The Professional. The movie that was Natalie Portman's first movie. I think she was like 12 years old or 13 years old. And this is actually an interesting. It's a tracking shot, which means that the camera is on a dolly and it's moving backwards as Gary Oldman walks toward the camera. Gary Oldman, if you know, is a very energetic actor. He's got a lot of presence and he's very physical. So when he's playing a detective who's coming in to kind of take over what's going on. So we do need a sense of place. And they shot him in a medium because we need to feel he's coming into an environment and he's going to be the boss, right? So we need to feel that environment, but we also want him to feel big. We want him to feel powerful, right? So if we were in a close-up, we wouldn't feel his presence in that environment, in the hallway, in the apartment. And if it was a big long shot where he's really far back and he's small in the frame, we're not going to have that feeling of the sense of him being a dominant, powerful character. So again, the medium shot here works quite well. And especially because it's a moving shot, it adds lots of dynamics and excitement to the shot. Okay? So these, again, guys, these are different examples of the medium shot at work and why a director would choose it, right? And why it tends to be, again, the most common shot in cinema. Okay? So we all know what movie that is, right?
Wizard of Oz.
Okay. Very good. Very good. It speaks for itself. Okay. Okay. So.
Medium shot.
Okay. I it would be nice if you all sang Somewhere Over the Rainbow.
Somewhere Over the Rainbow.
Yes. Okay. Well, you can sing. You can sing later. I'll post it on Facebook. Okay. Okay. So now we're moving in still closer. Now we have what we call a medium close-up. A medium close-up. Okay. If you look at where the shot is framed, just across the chest line, the nipple line. I don't mean to be rude, but if it's just below there, and if it was right a little bit above, it's going to have that same feeling of a body being sort of severed, a body being disconnected. So it's framed either just below or just above there, okay? And again, look at the top of the frame, everybody. There's still room. There's less, right? Mm-hmm. But there's still room, okay? In a medium close-up, which means you have you still a fair amount of body, right, in the shot, you still want to have some headroom, okay? Now also, as you get closer and closer, right, this will also limit the amount of movement that is your actors can do. Okay, we'll actually talk about this at some point. I wish I could show you. There's a great from the movie Seven. I think we talked about that a bit yesterday. The whole last sequence is mostly varying size close-ups. Okay. And you'll see that sometimes you'll actually have the character because he's very upset and he's in a lot of he's overwrought, right? He has to make a very big decision. He actually moves up and down and in and out of the frame. Now that's on purpose because the director wanted to create that sense of chaos, that sense of the character being all over the place. But generally speaking, as you get closer in. On a close-up, the actors have to be stiller and stiller because if they do too much, either they will leave the frame or they will violate the frame, right? They will be doing too much physical action for the frame to handle, okay? Now, good film actors know this. Good film actors know to limit their movement as the camera gets closer and closer, okay? We won't talk about matching. That's really for editing, but we'll touch on that later, okay? So that's from the movie Dune. Okay.
This guy had yesterday guessed the name of the film. That's with Matt McDowell.
That's very impressive.
There on the left corner.
I gotta look. Hold on. Where is he? Wave.
Wave.
Right. Wave. Left corner. Well done. Hey, in the back there. All right. Good for you.
Talking.
You okay. Got hiding in the dark there. Okay. Very good. Now, this also, I'm certain that just the way that this JPEG, just the way that this still photograph, you know, rendered into the PowerPoint is slightly wrong. I don't think that this is from The Godfather. It's Marlon Brando. I don't think that they cut off the top of his head this way. I think it's just the way the photograph went into the presentation. Okay, he should have more headroom. Okay, and I'm sure he does in the movie. Okay. Now, what's interesting here is you have varying degrees of background. You have varying degrees of environment. Okay, in Dune, David Lynch's film, he's just come out of this strange cylinder, right? I guess it's almost like a steam bath or something, and he's standing there, and he's very sweaty, and you know, we get all that environment. So again, we don't have to keep reminding the audience. It's more about his facial expression, because he's sort of flirting with someone, and they go in tight, and we still have all the steam and the smoke in the background. Okay, here we have almost no background because I'll just talk about this really quickly. This is the opening sequence of The Godfather, and what Coppola does is the opposite of everything that I'm telling you. What Coppola does is he starts with this character surrounded by darkness, right? And we don't really know where we are. But it gives the character a great sense of power and a great sense of mystery. And then what happens is during the course of, and we hear another voice off camera talking to him, asking the Godfather for a favor. Then the camera pulls back eventually, and what we see is that we're in the Godfather's private office in his home. We're in his study. So first he goes with the character and creates this air of power and mystery. Then he shows us the environment, okay? So again, it's a great example of the typical sequence done in reverse, but it's very, very effective, okay? I personally don't love the word rules. I prefer the word guidelines, right? There are certain guidelines. I think, like anything else, in any art form, there's a vocabulary, okay? Whether it's dance, or whether it's cinema, or whether it's martial arts, there's a vocabulary you have to learn. And then how you employ that vocabulary, that's up to you. That's your art, you know? Never-ending story. Okay, so now we're getting a little bit closer. Question about that?
I was just asking who guessed the name of the never-ending story. Somebody else also guessed it.
Oh, that's very impressive. That one's a little arcane, too. That one's a little hard to figure out, yeah. Yeah, also you can see they have these subtle touches in the background, right? We're not going to go into lighting today, but he's kind of hard lit. You know, we've got all this darkness over here, and then we've got the light coming in here. We've got the skull. So there's all these sort of elements in the shot in the background, right? That are contributing to the emotional, to the feeling of the shot, right? It's creating a bit of foreboding. It's creating a little bit of fear, even though we're on the boy and he's not himself afraid. It's just the elements behind him are creating an illusion and creating an emotional effect on the audience, okay? Okay, so now we're looking at a close-up. Not a medium close-up, but a close-up, okay? Usually of a person's face, it really should say always of a close person's face. In cinema, when we have a very tight shot of a face, we call that a close-up. When we have a very tight shot of an object, we call that an insert. Okay? So if you look, it's typically framed from just above the chest to the top of the head. Okay? A close-up emphasizes their emotional state and draws the viewer into the character's personal space, okay? We are now very intimate, very emotionally connected with the character. And again, that's why, as I said, what directors tend to do is wait on the close-up, right, until there's sufficient reason for the audience to be that emotionally connected to the character. Right? I mean, if we have two characters who start off a conversation and it's just, you know, chat. How are you? I'm fine. How was your day? It was good. How was the traffic? Oh, it wasn't bad. It was a little bit crowded. Are you hungry? Sure. I mean, it's not very important dialogue until somebody says, oh, by the way, your house burned down, right? You know, at that point, we may want to go in for a close-up because that character is probably going to have a big reaction to the news that his house just burned down, okay? So if you're in close-up the whole time, when the news gets delivered that the house burned down, it's not going to have the emotional impact on the audience because you've already been close, okay? Also, you'll notice that there's still a bit of headroom, okay? But now you can begin to play with this a little bit and you can begin to cut it off. By the way, we talked about cutting off at the joints, right? The neck, the chest line, the waist, the knees. The other place you don't want to cut off is at the hairline, okay? Because it looks like somebody scalped you, okay? As we say in old cowboy movies, right? Mm-hmm. Okay.
If I could interject here and tell
them. Please do.
Одоо энэ дээр чинь бол тэр нөгөө трансгендер юутай киноны санаа бол яг энэ хүний тэр юутай төл хөдлөлийг харуулах энэ бол хамгийн одоо танаа яа бол хамгийн одоо хийх фрейм үуч одоо иймэрхүү шат гаргах юм шүү дээ. Ер нь нөгөө бусад зохиолууд дээр ч гэсэн нөгөө байцаалтын санаа байна шүү дээ. Байцаалтан дээр одоо нөгөө хүнийг ингээд чи энэ хүн алсан байна ингээд зураг ингээд үзүүлээд байхад тэр хүн чи ингээд өөрөө өөрийгөө ингээд ингээд бүр ингээд сандраад яалаагүй шүү дээ гэдэг ингээд ойлж мөшөөд яадаг гэсэн шүү дээ тий. Тэр баг аль хэдийн танахан тий. Танахан дээр бас яг энэ тэр хүнийхээ одоо бүр ингээд сандраад яаж байгаа юм бүр ингээд ойроо close up-аар үзүүлэхгүй бол өөр аягаар бас үзүүлэх гэсэн шүү дээ.
За, okay, I'm done.
Okay. I understood every word.
I was just explaining them that, you know, the interrogation film and the makeup film ideas could use a lot of close-up because they have a lot of emotional content they want to show, which could be also only shown by close-ups, I was just telling them.
Yeah, no, that's absolutely right. Okay, so let me show you some examples.
Okay. We'll guess the examples. Which okay. Movies? We'll guess
I won't tell you. I feel like we should be playing for a prize, you know, like a terrible American game show. Okay, so let's look. What movie?
Nightmare on Elm Street.
Okay, all right. You all got that one. Okay. Yeah, also, you know, he's got his claw hand there. It is possible to have an object in the frame. The idea is that you don't want it to distract away too much. You know what I mean? You have to limit the movement. And the rule of thumb is you don't want it to cover the actor's face, you know, unless there's a good reason for that, okay?
Which one? Do you know?
No. Then you say Curious Case of Benjamin Button.
Okay.
Very good. Wow. Awesome, you guys. So yeah. This is interesting in that. Well, this is what we call an over the shoulder. We're going to come to this, right?
Mm-hmm. Okay, Blanchett in Norwegian, but how many times are asked Norwegian question? Over the shoulder, how many times are asked that the three? Around.
Okay.
That's the minimum.
Hello, Mr. Khan, can you hear us? Hello.
Бүх киног энэ таагаад болохоор жоохон уяашаа.
Hello, hello. Mr. Khan. Mr. Anderson.
That's good.
Hello. What should we do? Yeah, Timbilin, in Hunin, that's just. өөртөө full screen-ийг үзүүлдэг юм уу? Манай дэлгэц болно юм.
За байж гараа. За та хэлж гисэн. Оо гарсан байна шүү дээ.
Hi, are you there?
Yeah, we're there.
Okay, we lost. What happened? I think we lost the connection for a sec.
Yeah. But,
okay, are we okay now? You can see me?
Yeah.
Okay.
Can you see them?
Yes, I can.
Okay.
Let me
Had a short water break.
You want to take a little break?
That's okay. We're just in the water.
Yeah, sure.
But we'll take a break.
Give me just a sec. Let me get my Okay. So, do we see the PowerPoint again?
Yes, we can.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Good.
Yes.
All right.
Did we guess this one?
Which one is it?
The Harrison Ford.
Fugitive.
No.
Not Fugitive.
It's a tough one.
Indiana Jones, you know.
Nah. Indiana Jones and the Great Big Business.
Star Wars. Star Wars, The Business Strikes Back.
That's right. The Lawyer Strikes Back.
The Lawyer Strikes Back.
It's actually a movie called Regarding Henry. And it's the one where he's real mean, he gets bonked on the head, and then he becomes nice. So that's a little obscure. It's not one of his big action movies. Oh dear, hold on. Okay. Now we're going in even closer. What we call the tight close-up, okay? And we sometimes call this a choker. It's framed just below the chin to the top of the head. And again, In this frame size, you can cut off the top of the head, just don't cut it off on the hairline, okay? Don't cut it off, you know, right where you can see, you know, his hairline ends, okay? That is a choker of Matt Damon getting choked. anyone know this movie?
What kind of Goodwill Hunting.
That is very impressive, you guys. That is very, very impressive. That's awesome. Anyone know this movie?
Pulp Fiction. No.
Very good.
Oh, you guys Snakes on a Plane, I'm sure. Isn't it Snakes on a Plane?
Snakes on a Plane. Okay, just kidding. No, it's Shaft. That's the opening scene. That's a tasty burger. It's that one. Look at the big brain on Brad. Okay. You can see, let me just go back a little bit, that even at these scenes, which these shots, which are slightly different, right? The angles are slightly different in terms of our orientation toward the camera. His face is tilted up. His face is tilted slightly down. She's almost dead on. We still have the focal point in the eyes. And actually, if you look closely, just look at the eyes for a second, you can see they're lit. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Okay.
That's, anyone know? That's Grace Kelly. You know what that's from?
Grace Kelly. It's when?
Yeah, this is an old movie.
Vertigo. Somebody said Vertigo. Vertigo.
Good guess. Very good guess. She was in Vertigo. It was around the same time period. It's actually from another Hitchcock film called To Catch a Thief.
To Catch a Thief.
Yeah, with Cary Grant. Okay. And I think it was on this movie that she met the Prince of Monaco and married him and literally became a princess. A little movie trivia for you, okay? All right? Okay, so again, also look at the hairline, right? Barely cut off here, cut off a bit more significantly here, and so on, okay? Next is what we call the ECU, or the extreme close-up, okay? So this is definitely a shot that we don't want to overuse. The eyes are the focal point. And it's too close to show, you know, general emotional reactions. There's no sense of space or geography whatsoever, but it can heighten the drama in extreme situations.
Right.
Yep, that's very good. Silence of the Lambs, yep. Anyone know this one?
Fear and Loathing in
Yes, last very good. Well, I'm applauding you. I'm applauding you. This is based on a novel by a great writer named Hunter Thompson, who is my favorite writer. And I'll just point out a couple of interesting things about this shot. This is Johnny Depp as a sort of crazy journalist based on Hunter Thompson. What they're doing in this shot is they're shooting a close-up with a wide-angle lens, okay? I'm not going to go too much into lenses and stuff. I know you're going to have some additional cinematography instruction. But these are shot with your typical close-up lenses, the telephoto lenses, right? The focus is on the face. The background is somewhat out of focus, right? That's generally what you get with a telephoto lens for a close-up, okay? Here, okay, and even so, if you look, the focal point here is the eyes. The background is literally his shirt, and you'll see it's somewhat fuzzy. It's somewhat out of focus. That's perfectly okay. There's a gazillion shots that are designed that way. It's simply used. It's a little bit stylized. It's a little bit cinematic, but it draws us closer into the eyes and closer into that emotion. This is shot with a wide-angle lens. Now, I will tell you a couple things about doing this. First of all, actors hate it. They really hate it. Except people like Johnny Depp, who love to look, I mean, to his credit as an actor, he loves to look crazy, he loves to look silly, right? He loves to look outrageous. So this is shot with a wide-angle lens. You see there's more background, it's a little bit more in focus. And a wide-angle, shooting a close-up with a wide-angle lens will distort the actor's figures, right? It's almost like a bit of a. Do you know what a fisheye is? Do you know that that
He says the lens that Wes Anderson uses.
Yes, Wes Anderson does that a lot. In fact, I have that's very, very smart. In fact, the examples that I have in another lecture of this technique are taken from some Wes Anderson movies. He does it all the time in Royal Tenenbaums, right? Because he wants those characters to feel a little, they're odd. They're all kind of strange, unusual people. So that's very, very smart. And so Wes Anderson, that's something he does quite a bit. So in this case, you know, you get this sort of distorted effect, and it's generally good for comedy. It can work in horror. It can work in anything where you don't want it to look naturalistic, okay? Where you want it to look a little bit heightened, a little bit stylized, okay? Do you want to just explain that?
Yeah. Okay. Юу яг бол нөгөө аимшиг кинонд дэр ч юм уу Wes Anderson-ийн кинонд дэр ч юм уу нэг яг ингээд шууд ингээд харуулахгүй бас нэг тийм нэг сони нэг хүний нүдэн жоох нэг өрмц харагдуулахын тулд энэ wide angle үүсгэдэг. Энэ дэр бас би зүгээр нэг яг Johnny нөгөө Rango дэр бас нэг гүрүүлч нэг яддаг шүү дээ машин дарилдаг шүү дээ. Чи яг энэ юм ингээд шоотсон биш. Тийм зөв зөв. Rango-гийн юм уу нэг цанч нэг яаж.
Okay.
Okay. All right, so another extreme close-up.
Guess this movie. Yeah.
You know what? I don't remember. I know.
Nicolas Cage? Is that Nicolas Cage?
Or I don't know. I don't think so.
Maybe, yeah. Good, bad, and ugly. The good, the bad, and ugly.
It may be. We're gonna look at some clips from Good, Bad, and the Ugly. So it may be, but it's not. I know it's not from the climactic gun battle, which I'm gonna show you. Okay. I'm sorry. Can you just give me just 2 seconds? I'll be right with you.
Okay.
Yeah. Just 2 seconds.
Okay.
Yeah. Хайр дүрний шатууд нь ямар байна? Одоо ерөөсөө дараагийн өнөөдрийн ерөөсөө зорилго маань та нар сценараа яг ямар шатуур явах үг гэж харна. Одоо та нарын нөгөө юм дээр чинь дасгалын сториборд хийх ингээд дасгалын юу гэж байна шүү дээ. А тэрэн дээр та нар нөгөө задлаад яаж шүү дээ. Зураа шүү дээ. Okay.
Okay. So now I'm going to show you a clip. This is the final shootout from The Good, the Bad and the Ugly, which you mentioned. So pay attention to how they go from the wide shots that establish geography and the character's orientation to each other and how they move in, and they have a lot of fun with close-ups and inserts, okay? So let's have a look at this. This clip lasts about 5 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah.
We're seeing it. With a little freeze, but we're seeing it.
I'm going to go to the camera. Ugly challenge. In bad thing. In ugly. Yeah. In the picture, what do you do? Don't stop at the end. Much in him, Harold does that. Wild shot. That background out of sound. Honest and all. Амар хоёулын зэрэг хөдөлсөөр бас амар синхроник гэдэг гой харагдаж байна. Тэр нэг том гон дээр араа. Гурван өөр газар. Хаан. Том.
So pay attention particularly from now, from this wide, and watch how they establish perspective.
Да, но перспектив гэж ярьдаг шүү дээ. Аслаа амар сайн харуулж байгаа. Medium shot. This is close up. Over the shoulder with the sheen off. The movement is not half. I've just made it. Close up. I mean, emotions are just close up. I'm not close up. Tight close up. Улам ингээд амар теншнтэй болон ингээд хэцүү болоод хүмүүс ингээд I'm shot in. Mr. Khan, I think we have a freeze or the clip has ended.
Yeah, it's ended. Okay. So okay. Tell me what you guys noticed in terms of the shot selection.
Okay, I'm shot.
He says, first they established perspective.
Yes.
And then it shrunk from the wider shots. It shrunk to a several degree.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So from extreme, it reached the extreme shot, extreme close up,
right.
And then it became wider again.
Right.
Medium shot.
Right. Because now why? Why did they go back to the wide shot after all the eyes and all the fast cutting? Why did they go back to the wide shot there?
Yeah, no. Perspective, maybe. To show the perspective again.
Right.
Anybody else want to answer this? Why did they go back to the wide shot? So there's lots of eyes. To show, is it? Someone over there says, "Who shot whom?"
Exactly. Right, because there's a moment. We need to see exactly where the who shot who. And by going back to the wide, mm-hmm. there's a moment of doubt. There's a moment of suspense as to who's going to die. Uh-huh. Now, also, did you notice, right, that once they do a lot of establishing a perspective, they give you the overall geography, and then there's a lot of shots that establish the perspective of each character to the other. We have. We have two shots, we have over-the-shoulder shots, right? We have one look one way, and then we cut to that point of view, so we have point of view shots. All of this is laid in at the beginning of the fight.
Okay.
So when they go really close.
Educational. Sorry, Mr. Khan, we just received a warning. But somebody also said because now that the shooting has been done and the emotion or the tension has been released,
yes.
They're going back to the wide shots. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's correct, right? Then they go back to the wide, then they go back to mediums, right? On Eli Wallach and on Clint, because we're wondering if Clint's going to kill him too, right? But you're right. The tension going back, you make a very, very good point, and it's going to be part of the next clip I'm going to show you. When you cut back to a wide shot in the middle of a scene, you are releasing the tension of the scene. Okay? When you are in close, that's all that stuff we talked about, it being emotionally connected, emotionally bound up with the characters. And when you go wide, that releases the tension. Now, that's not necessarily a bad thing. There may be points in a scene where you want to release the tension and then bring it back again. Okay? But you'll notice that all those super close-ups of all the eyes and the head turns and all that were very easy for us to follow. We always knew who was looking at who, right? Because they established all the perspective in the wides, all right? And that's what I said earlier about the audience's brain is like a computer. Because we were shown again and again and again where each character was, where they were in relationship to each other. We figured it out. We didn't have to be reminded, okay? And then obviously Leone has a lot of fun with the cutting and the editing. Okay, so it's a pretty good example of what we're talking about. Okay, we're gonna take a break at 10:50 still. Is that still the plan?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. Good. Because we can pick up with the boards and stuff after the break. But let's try to get through all of this, okay? All right, the next thing that we look at is what we call the two shot, okay? Very simply, it's any shot that contains two people. We have wide twos, we have tight twos, we have medium twos, okay? Now, the over-the-shoulder is the most common shot when we're shooting dialogue, okay? When you shoot somebody in a scene, when you shoot a solo shot of them, it's called a single. Okay? And again, I don't mean to be rude, but in America, we call them clean singles and dirty singles. Okay? A dirty single means that we see the shoulder of the other actor in the shot. And you'll see this is very common in dialogue because it reminds the audience that there's a conversation. It reminds the audience that the other person is there. Okay? Now, sometimes you may want to isolate a reaction without having the presence of the other character in the shot, so it's just the one character without the shoulder, that's what we call a clean single, okay? Now, we're going to come back to this in a bit, But when we establish the line, the camera line in a scene, we always have to shoot the same. So we're always going to shoot Kevin Spacey over, you guys know what movie this is?
I'm going to, LA Confidential.
Very good.
Yeah. Mr. Khan, I have just one more note.
Sure.
My Hangout says the Hangout on Air will end if you continue broadcasting content you aren't authorized to use. I think it's some sort of a copyright issue. So I'm suggesting a solution that is perhaps we could, because we already downloaded this presentation as well, we could show it from our end.
Okay. Well, show. That's very strange.
Or maybe we could end it this way. I mean, let's keep it as this. I'm just concerned if the Hangout might end abruptly.
Okay.
But, we're not showing anything like illegally.
No, we're not. I mean, again, this, yeah. All right. Well, I mean, there is one other clip.
Mm-hmm.
But these are just still photos. I don't know. I can't imagine why this would be a problem. If it does, then we can do that. Hey, we can do it from your end. Okay. Let's try to keep going. So, all right. Okay. So you'll notice that we're always going to shoot Kevin Spacey over Guy Pearce's right shoulder, and we're always going to shoot Kevin Spacey over. I mean, Guy Pearce over Kevin Spacey's. I'm sorry, I got that wrong. It's Guy Pearce's left shoulder. It's Spacey's right shoulder. Okay.
Right.
Mm-hmm. All right. An insert is a close-up of something that's part of the scene. And it's used to give emphasis or to tell the audience something is important.
Okay.
So he's going to give the money, and then we cut to an insert of the actual bill. Okay? So anytime we do a close-up of an object, guys, it's called an insert. And usually, again, if you do an insert on something, that is going to tell the audience that at least for the moment, this is important. Right, that it's something they should pay attention to and probably remember. Okay. So the master shot again. Now the wide shot is the focal length. The master shot is the. Let me put it to you this way: is the purpose. Okay. Usually, a master shot will be a wide or a long shot. Okay.
Okay.
Okay, let's look at this this clip from LA Confidential, and take notice of a couple of things. Take notice of the difference. They're actually both have a lot of close-ups, but you'll notice that when they cut back and forth, usually their close-ups are slightly different in size. Also, look for where they cut back to the master shot to release the tension in the scene, and then we'll talk about why they do it. Okay.
Okay. I think we have no audio.
It's very low.
Uh-huh.
Тэгэхээр энэ нь шоттуудаа харж байгаа юм чинь тийм. Яг одоо over the shoulder гэдэг энэ нь хараад байхгүй. Тэр basing green нөгөө юунаас нь харуулчихвал их муухай харагдаж штэ. Яг тэр натлын 108 дотор л ингэ эргээд байх штэ. Нөгөө мөрнийхэн талаас нь харуулвал. Russell Crowe дохны хайжууд нь батгтай юм штэ. Үсгийн хайж. Яг олч гэсэн нэг амар том юу гарцсан юм бэ? Тэр паспорт.
Mr. Khan, can we turn up the volume a bit?
I have it up all the way at my end.
Okay. No, we're just analyzing the shots.
That's fine. That's perfectly okay. Because you can tell by their action, by their mm-hmm. acting, what's going on.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Maybe Mera just scroll it. Cool, actually. чи угаасаа тэгсэн билдэ нэ тээ. Hello, confidentially, with two men. Yeah, you will join it.
See, a telephoto close up.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
So, in that scene, right? We noticed that these two people, he's a cop and she's a prostitute that looks like a movie star, and they kind of play this little game with each other. And you'll notice that the person who's in the tightest close-up in those exchanges is usually the one who's the more uncomfortable, right? Making them feel more on the spot, making them feel more constrained and constricted. The person who's in a little more control has a little more room, so they feel a little bit more relaxed. Then you'll notice that there's a moment where Russell Crowe feels uncomfortable, and he walks away from her because he doesn't know what to say, and they go back to the wide. And then she pursues him to the window because she's not going to let go of her questions. And then what happens? He says something to her very sweet. He says that she's prettier than the movie star, and she doesn't know what to do. Now she's embarrassed a little bit, and now she feels uncomfortable, so she walks away to break the tension, and he pursues her. So a lot of times what you'll see in staging, guys, is people are pursuing and retreating. That's a very easy way to think about how to stage a scene. It's pursuing and retreating. Okay, but the wide shots, they go back to the wide shots to break the tension momentarily in the scene, only to then build it back up again by going back to the close-ups. Okay, does that make sense?
Yeah, and also if I could interject here,
please.
누구 작다다 얘기하고 싶대? 작다 보고 누구 누구 욕 이야기 갖다 갔다. 그 누구 실수 누구 сэжигтнийг байцаагаар чинь хүмүүсийг алсан гэдэг байна шүү дээ. Тэгэхээр сэжигтэн бол амар ингээд духгүй болчиход байгаа шүү дээ. Тэр духгүй болсны бүр ингээд амар тайч шатар үзүүлээд а цагдаа бол ингээд хүн цагдж байгаа юм чинь бас арай жоохон духтаа байгаа шүү дээ. Тэрнийг нь жоохон цагдаатай ингээд жоохон цаад бэкграунд нь оруулж өгөөд нэг жоохон зай оруулж өгөх юм бол тэр хоёрын ялгаа үүсгэж харагддаг байна шүү дээ. Миний хэлэн дээр. За, окей.
Окей. All right. This next concept is what we call the line. Okay? And it's a way to keep track of what side of the action to place our camera. So imagine this. We have these two characters standing each other. There's a 180-degree line that runs through them. And if you look at where we put the cameras, right, the camera's over one character's left shoulder, the other camera's over the other character's right shoulder, okay? If we take one of those cameras and we move it to the other shoulder, it will look like they've jumped to the other side of the screen. Okay, so kind of go here. You'll see here. There's no dialogue. I mean, there's no sound. So he's walking toward him. They stop for a second. They establish the perspective, right? Each shoulder, right? They're going to cut back to that shoulder. Now, even as they walk down the hall, right, they don't change. They're going to stay with those same shoulders, even though now they're a little bit closer. Okay? If you change the camera from Kevin Spacey's right shoulder to Kevin Spacey's left shoulder, okay, this is what happens. Okay, this is inaccurate. Okay, it will look like the characters, you see how they're jumping from one side of the screen to the other? It will look like when you cut. Right? 1, 2. This is just being a little funny because of the... Right? So she always has to be screen left, he always has to be screen right. To move the camera, right? Oh, look, all of a sudden he's on the other side of the screen. You see?
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So once you establish what we call the line, right? Once you establish the line, you can't change it. Okay, I'm not going to play you this clip, it's too long. Okay, All right, so very quickly, a couple of other small framing concepts, okay? Now, those are all the basic shots, okay? Are there any questions about any of these? Because this is pretty much...
Any questions?
Yeah, this is the that's the vocabulary of shots, okay?
Okay. Now, sorry, Mr. Khan. So, one of our participants has, the idea was that this guy does a makeup on his face, right? And so what he's trying to convey is that he's painting his eyes. So he's asking what kind of shots should he use? What kind of shots he should use for this to convey shots?
Hold on, I'm sorry. Okay, can you please, I lost you a little bit there. Can you
Sure.
Say it to me one more time.
Okay, so one of our team's film script is about a guy under a spotlight applying makeup to his face. So it's a long shot. It's trying to convey a lot of emotion. So
right.
The question is, what kind of shots should he use, and how should he position the eyes? How should he shoot the eyes?
Well, I mean, if you're shooting into a mirror, one thing you can do, depending on how big the mirror is, you could.
There's no mirror, right? There's no mirror. He's just under a spotlight. He's on a stage. He's alone. The theater auditorium is empty, and he's just applying makeup, apparently, without mirror.
Do we want this character to feel? What is the relationship emotionally that he wants us to have with this character? How does he want the audience to feel about this character?
It's that he gets happier the more makeup he applies. The more womanly he looks, the happier he feels.
Okay.
So he's trying to show how to convey the happiness through his eyes.
Okay. Well, then one thing you can do is you can play with the angle that you shoot him at, right? If you shoot down, right? If you shoot down onto a subject, onto a character, that will make them feel smaller and more vulnerable, right? So if you maybe think about shooting down at the beginning when he's not happy, when he's, upset, and then when he gets happier, then you bring the camera more level with him and put the camera so we're equal to his eye line, okay? So he goes from being vulnerable and small to being more powerful and happy and accessible by putting the camera on his eye line. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I understand. Okay. Өөр асуух юм уу? Та нар бас энэ юугаа бас асууж болох юм ба шүү дээ. Яг одоо ямар англиар энэ юугаа илэрхийлэх үүтэй тохиолдох санаа гэдэг нь. Таны хувьд бол өөр асуулт байна уу?
Okay. Okay.
Okay. I think they'll ask you later sure. On each team.
Why don't we come? Well, what if you want to stay? If you want to stay on schedule, why don't we take our break now?
Yeah.
And finish up these last couple of things.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Look at the other stuff.
Okay.
Okay. So 20 minutes.
Yeah, 20 minutes. We'll see you in 20 minutes.
Terrific. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Okay. Should we keep the broadcast on?
Yeah, that might be the easiest.
Okay, yeah, because reconnect.
You don't tempt fate,
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
We'll see you in 20 minutes.
What the hell?
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you. сурулж ирээд нэг сайхан
Mr. Khan, are you there?
I am.
Okay. We are finishing the...
Okay.
Okay.
I'll be right there. I'm here.
Төвшин байна уу?
Байна.
Үлгөө? Тэр үлгөө.
Аа.
Гишүүд орж. Мөнх хэлтэн. Сумья. Огт хоёр.
Байна.
Нэг цагийн үлгөө. Нэг цагийн үлгөө байхгүй.
Байна.
Аа. Шинжтик. Алтан чулуу.
Аа.
Батлаг.
Байна.
Okay. Yeah.
All right, Mr. Khan, we're ready. All complete.
All right, we ready? Okay, everyone ready? Okay. So, let's just finish up a couple of things here. We looked briefly at... all right. Just a second. Okay, can you see the... do you know what movie that's from?
2001.
Someone said 2001? That's right. Very good. So you can see here, you have multiple frames within a frame. It draws the viewer's eye deep into the shot. It creates this particularly was designed so it's what we call a forced perspective, which means as the astronaut moves further and further away, the frame seems to tunnel. It seems to grow smaller and sort of infinite. Okay, we looked at that one. And the last camera technique is what we call the Dutch tilt. Okay, with that base, and you have to be a little careful about overusing this because it's a very good technique, but it does tend to be a little overdone. If you slightly tilt the camera to the left or the right, it usually means the character is feeling unease or tension, and it creates a skewed, sort of anxious perspective. Okay, again, it can work very, very well. Did anyone know this movie?
How can I? 25th Hour?
No.
Master.
No.
It's the same actor. It's Philip Hoffman. It's called Doubt. And the movie's called Doubt.
Doubt.
Yeah. And it's about a priest who has been accused of molesting a boy. And we never really know if he did it or not, okay? But he is in a position of great, you know, he's being accused and he's going to lose possibly his priesthood and his reputation. So they're shooting him at this angle to heighten that feeling of tension and anxiety, okay? See if you can guess that one.
What movie?
And that's a hard one.
Dark Knight, okay.
Yeah, very good, Dark Knight.
Looks like a ballet movie, you know, to me.
Yes, that's right. You can tell by the Joker's socks. What they do in this shot is they actually tilt the camera as Batman pulls him over the table. So it feels like the whole world is being thrown upside down, the whole world is being thrown into disarray, okay? Sometimes the camera movement can actually help create, you know, by the way you move the camera and the point of the scene when you at which you move it can add tension and create an emotional response in the audience, okay? I mean, the rule of thumb is you try to not draw attention to the camera. You don't really want the audience to notice it's there. You just want them to feel it, you know? But certainly in something like this, it's great to play with it and, you know, and try to be a bit more stylized, you know? Okay. I'm going to now... Okay, so that is our directing lecture. Mm-hmm. Let's look, so we'll do a brief lecture now on just a brief presentation on storyboarding. Just give me one sec, guys. Let me just pull up the document. Just give me a moment. Okay. Hopefully this will work.
Okay.
Just a sec.
So I've given them the storyboarding template.
Everyone. Oh, great. They have it in front of them with the pictures?
Yeah.
Okay.
Algo menu. Chat.
Do you see it now on the screen?
Do you
see it now on the... I tried to put it up like the PowerPoint. Do you see it?
Yep.
Oh, okay, great. Okay, now let me talk about a few things about, you know, storyboarding, guys. It's a lot of instruction. We spend a lot of time with our students teaching them how to storyboard, and you know, it is a time-consuming process. So we're just going to really talk about just the basic concepts behind storyboarding, and I'm sure that, you know, your teacher there will help you because it's kind of a lot easier to do sitting in a room. But what's that?
I will help them.
Okay, awesome. There you go. Okay. Oh wait, where'd it go? Okay. So you still see it?
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. Yay. All right. The idea of a storyboard. Oh gosh. I'm sorry, guys. Hold on. Okay. The idea of a storyboard is this. It's what we call pre-visualization of your scene. Okay. Because before you go and you shoot the scene, you have to know in advance every shot that you need to get. To get the coverage you need for the scene, all right? Eventually, what you have to come up with is what we call a shot list, which means on a given day, you have a certain number of shots that you've pre-planned that you're going to get in order to cover the scene for that day, okay? Movie production lives and dies by the shot list, okay? You have to get, you know, if you don't get your shots in, then you have to get them in the next day. And if you don't get them in the next day, what can happen is all of a sudden you are behind schedule and there's not time and there's not money to finish. So the way that we are sure that we are, not only are we sure artistically of what we want to shoot, and then we have the footage that we need in the editing room to edit the scene together, but it's also about being efficient on set with time, okay? One of the things that I say to my students all the time is that your most valuable asset when you're shooting is not money and it's not talent, it's time. Because once time is gone, you can't get it back, all right? So the more economical you are with time, the better you use time, the better product you'll have. And when you think about it, it really comes down to one very simple idea. What you want to do is to have the most time on set on a given day with the camera rolling. That is what we're shooting for. Okay? So, let's talk a little bit about storyboards. There's two kinds of storyboards, what we call the shooting board and the cutting board. Okay? This is an example of what we would call a shooting board. Okay? So, what you do is you know, obviously as a director, you read the scene, and then you figure out what are the key story points in the scene, and you figure out where your camera is going to be at every single moment in the scene, okay? So what you're doing is you're basically cutting the scene together in your head before you shoot it, right? So you're imagining, okay, we'll start with a wide shot, then I'll go to a close-up of this or a medium shot of this character. Then I'll go to a medium shot of the other character. And then the waitress approaches, so I'll shoot the waitress coming to the table. Then I'll shoot the two of them looking at the menu. You know, what you do is you basically, in the old days, what you would do, and I can't draw at all. I am the worst artist ever. I can't draw a stick figure. So things like this are very helpful for me. What you would do is you would actually make little drawings, right? So this is something that we work on at school. Okay, we actually do scenes, we do episodes from a TV show called Frasier, an old television show. So here's the first scene. Shot one, scene seven. Okay, it's all scene seven, okay? On dolly, track into overpan into two shots. So what that means is this. We're starting, the camera's on a dolly, okay, it's going to move, it's going to start on this one guy, and then it's going to move into position, right, so you'll have both people in the scene. So this is the first shot, and this is the basic instruction, right? The camera's going to track over and go into a two shot, okay? Okay, now, if you look, this is the upper left, this is where the shot starts, and then on the upper right, that's where the shot ends. Get it? Because this is a moving shot, so we're showing where the shot begins, we make a note that the camera's going to pan, and then on the right, that's where the shot ends. Okay? Alright? Now, what usually you'll do is you may put, if necessary, you could put a little note in. You know, you could put a note that says, Frasier reads the paper, his father enters drunk, okay? Just a very simple line that tells you the action you're shooting, okay? But if you see, again, let's look at those first two frames. On dolly means the camera's on a dolly, right? So we're moving, we're physically moving the camera. Track to overpan into a two shot, and on the right is our two shot, okay? Then scene two, over F on M. So that means over Frasier on whatever character M is. I forget the character's name. So what that is, over F, if you look at the second shot on the left, the second one down, it's an over-the-shoulder shot, right, at a slight angle on M, the white-haired character. M is the father, I believe. Okay? That makes sense?
Yeah.
Then, if we go to shot number three, that says complementing, okay, over M on F. So that goes back, just go back to those over-the-shoulder shots that we looked at in LA Confidential, right? We call these either a matching shot or an answer shot, okay? and I'm going to talk to you a little bit about this when we talk about working with an editor and a DP. But generally speaking, the general rule is, and I actually have asked several editors about this, and they all agree, that if you shoot an over-the-shoulder one way, so let's go to shot number two, if you shoot an over-the-shoulder over F on M, you are obligated to shoot the reverse. You are obligated to shoot the reverse perspective, which is over M, which means over M's shoulder, onto Fraser. That makes sense, guys? So now, we've essentially, these are the first four shots of our scene. There's our first shot. It's a moving camera, moves into this position, right? The next shot we'll shoot is then are over the shoulders, okay?
So, Mr. Khan, I have one question.
Yeah.
So, if you could scroll up a bit.
Yes.
The first two shots, it says, over pan on dolly, but it looks like Fraser's character didn't move at all. I mean, composition-wise.
No, he's not moving. The camera's moving.
Yeah, but I mean, his size hasn't shifted inside the composition.
No, he has.
Okay. So he has.
Look, no.
It's very small.
Look at the difference between the size he is in the frame.
Uh-huh.
On the left versus the size he is in the frame on the right.
Uh-huh.
He's bigger in the frame on the right. That's because the camera's dollied in, okay? When the camera dollies in, that means you're getting closer to your subject and they're going to be bigger in the frame. But you can see an appreciable difference in how big he is in the frame from the beginning of the shot to the end of the shot.
Okay.
That makes sense?
Yeah, but when you say over pan, does the camera move sidewise, or is it zooming in, or
no? Well, let's go. First of all, there's a difference. There's two ways, in a sense, to move closer to your subject. One is a zoom, and one is a dolly or a push. Okay, when you push, what that means is, or dolly if you're on dolly tracks. That means that the camera is physically moving closer to the subject. It means the whole camera is moving, whether it's on dolly, whether it's on a handheld, whether it's on a shoulder rig. It means the camera itself is moving closer to the figure. A zoom means the camera itself is not moving. You're just changing the focal length of the lens. Okay. Now there's a real difference between the two, and I can if I had time. Show you an example of this, but a push tends to be more natural looking, okay? Because a push will tend to keep the background in focus longer, okay? A zoom, because what you're doing with a zoom is essentially you're going from a shallow focus to a deep focus, okay? And what that does is it defocuses the background, all right, when you zoom in. So a zoom can be effective, right? It can be very... there are certain styles of film, like mockumentaries, like fake documentaries, or like Blair Witch, like found footage movies, where the camera is supposed to be just, randomly capturing things as they occur. So you would zoom a lot with that, right? Because it makes sense in the style of the movie. Okay? But generally speaking, your first option is usually a push, because it is a more natural-looking camera movement. It calls less attention to itself, okay? Then you have your over-the-shoulder one and your over-the-shoulder two, okay? Mm-hmm. Then our fourth shot, take Fraser from couch seat to door profile, okay? So what that means is that we're going to move the camera. Fraser's going to get up from the couch, and he's going to move into this position, okay? So the camera's going to move with him. All right? That's our next shot. And we plan this out in advance, right? Because if the blocking of the scene, right, the staging of the scene is that he's got to go to the door, right? Well, we know that. We planned it. He's on the couch. We know he's got to get to the door. So then we figure out how is the camera going, how are we going to shoot that? So in this case, we have a camera movement. The camera moves with Fraser to the door profile. Then we're cutting to another angle, right, which is a low angle, right, which means you're shooting from below up onto Fraser, right, because we have a reaction that we want to see. Fraser shot to see whoever's at the door. Okay? So this is a very simple visualization of the scene. Okay? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 shots. Okay? Well, it's really 5 shots because this is one continuous. Now, there's also, just quickly, there's a program that you can buy that I recommend. It's an application. You can get it for iPad. You can get it for iPhone. It's got a lot of different platforms, and it's called Artemis. Okay? And what Artemis, it's very useful. It has in the program a list of, like, every camera you can think of. It's got movie cameras. It's got digital cameras. It's got SLRs. It's, you name it. So what you do, essentially, is this. You would click on the camera you're using. Then you'd click on the lens, okay, because it'll give you a choice of lenses. And then you make that your frame. And then you can use it as a viewfinder, or they used Artemis to create the storyboard. Because Artemis will give you the exact frame that you'll be shooting in, right? Because we know different lenses give you different frames and different focal lengths and different depth of field. So you can use that to take photos, right, to kind of create your storyboard.
Yeah, let me explain a bit on that Artemis. I think I saw on Google Android.
Yeah,
Android otsta. Yeah, so how iPhone to humus iten. Or durben. Yeah, so my key was here to you was her program was her Artemis get to iPhone or iOS to the program. Энэ програм нь яадаг вэ гэхээр storyboard яг ингээд зураг аваад шууд бэлтүүлж болдог. Ямар камера, ямар лензэр авах вэ гэдэг нь бэлтүүлдэг байхгүй. А Android дээр бол бас та нар зөвхөн storyboard setting ч юм уу ингээд бичих бас янз янз юм хийж илээ. Ахуд тэрүүгээр бас та нар хийж болно даа. Гэтэ өнөөдрийн юм бол хэдүүлээ зураал явчих заавал нэг санд. Энэ дээр 35 минут. Зөв нэг дөнгө medium shot гэсэн үг байдаг. Өнөөдөр
ахын дотор close up авсан тийм. Тэгээд
85 гэж
байна. Аа. Өөр ингэ average scale ахын дотор ослын 85 байдаг. Аха. Өөрөөр хэлбэл авч байгаа. 35 мм гэдэг чинь одоо дурангийн хэмжээ юу? 35 мм. Үүнийг кино дурангч өөрөөр андаа тохиол. Танай анзаард бол телевизэнд үзэж яхад ингээд artist ингээд очд нь штэ. Кино гэж хэлсэн байх. Дурангууд надад тохиол.
15
ойлгохгүй дараа зураг авчихсан. Яг нэг том юм халаанд явж байгаа курсны бага тамиг. Нэг курсны том хүний ингээд нүр ингээд одоо авши талаа авчтай зурагаар би курсны бага тавьчихвал нэг нүр ингээд байт болчих.
Аа за за.
Жишээний тийм хүний сонголтыг
хийх. Аа за за. So our facilitator is telling that each shot should also plan the size of the lens
I was going to go over that. If you look, it's a little confusing because 35 millimeter is also used to be a size of film, but if you look on the sheets, it says Arri Alexa, that's the camera. The Arri is a camera, okay? And then it also says it's generic 35 millimeter lenses. That it's, I think on the right it says 35 millimeter. That means they're shooting this scene with a 35 millimeter lens, okay?
Okay.
So. Yes, absolutely. When you're planning out the shot, well, you know, a lot of times, Let me take that back. I mean, you can do it. That is really the least important thing, though. Okay, that's really more the director of photography's job. He really is the one who selects the. I mean, you can suggest, but the DP is really the person who has the knowledge of lenses and camera, and will choose the lens that'll best realize the shot the director wants. Okay, and look, with a good DP, if the DP tells you, you know, look, you need to shoot this with an 85, a director is usually not going to argue, you know, because that's what the DP is paid to do. Okay, but it's certainly not a bad idea to have. I'm going to talk about this in working with the director of photography. Directors should have some basic knowledge of lenses. They should have some basic knowledge of you know, focus and depth of field and these kinds of issues. Okay. Now the other thing I want to there's more. Okay. So then we have shot six. Okay. And you can see from here, right? All of these shots are planned out. Over Fraser on B looking down, angle on B from M, okay, and so on and so on. Now, here's what I want to point out. This is a what we would call a cutting board. What this does is it visualizes the way the scene will cut together in the editing room. Things always change a little bit in the editing room. You always kind of make some adjustments and all that. But basically, you're saying, this is the way the scene's going to look, right, when we cut it together and the audience watches it. That is different from what we call the shooting board, okay? Because the order in which you shoot shots is different from the order in which they appear in the film, okay? And this is, again, for time efficiency. So let me give you an example. Let's go to shot number two, okay? Shot number two over Fraser on M, okay? So you can see that the angle here, we're shooting against this back wall and we're shooting this character, the white-haired man, okay, the dad. Let's say that we want three or four shots of him. So what we're not going to do is shoot this shot, then we go back to another shot of him, then another shot of Fraser. We're going to figure out what are all the shots we can get of this character while the camera is pointed in this direction against this wall. So let's say we're going to do our over the shoulder. That's one. Then let's say we're going to do a clean single, meaning just him in the frame. That's a second one. Let's say we want to do an extreme, you know, a tight close-up of him on a reaction. That's a third one. Maybe also we want to do an insert where he pulls something from his pocket. So in other words, that cluster of shots, right, will be shot one after the other because the camera is positioned here and it's more, it's less time consuming to shoot everything out we can on him against that wall before he moves. Does that make sense? So we may be shooting a reaction shot, you know, in that cluster of shots, then maybe wouldn't be till the very end. I mean, maybe the reaction shot is, you know, I mean, I'm just making it up, but maybe the reaction shot is this one, okay, is number 10.
Even though,
in the cutting.
Яг cutting board гэдэг дээр бол яг зохиолдоо бүр эхнээс нь ахлаа за энийг ингэж яана гэхэл ингэж зурглалын ингээ гаргачихлаа шүү дээ. Яг shooting board гэдэг маань болохоор зарим зургийг яг хэцүү байдаг юм уу зарим зургийг яг амархан бол эхлээ хэцүүгээ дуусгачаа дараа нь амархнаа хийдэг. Эхлээд амархнаа дуусгаж хамгийн зүйл хэцүү нэг юм. Тэр нэг зураг авалтад давалтынхаа явцд нөгөө цаг хэмнэх зорилгоор дахиад нэг юу гаргаж storyboard гаргаж гэж байлаа. Тэрний хаяг одоо ингээл зарим хүмүүсийн цаг зав хараад хамгийн зүйл реакттай юу гэдэг асан байдаг юм уу те. Тэргээр нь ярьж байгаа. Тэр зураг авах дараа л бол гэсэн үг. Аа.
Does that make sense, Natsu?
Yeah, our facilitator was just saying one more thing.
Okay, sure.
Wide shot after. Эхлээд дүүл close up авчаад үйл нүлэмс үзүүлсэнийг харуулчаад дараа нь хамаарч
дараа томоор
тийм шүү дээ. Okay. Okay, we're done.
Okay. thanks for clearing that up. Okay. So from these storyboards, right, eventually what we come up with, just give me a second here, I have to open another document. Just bear with me for a second.
It's less visible for you.
Okay. Yeah, less visible. Do you see the shot list I just put up?
Yeah.
Okay. So, I mean, again, this is slight differences here, everybody, because this is actually from a, you know, from television, but the basic principle is the same, right? What it's telling you is this: if you look at the shot, it'll give you the shot. Okay. It'll give you a brief description, right? ECU on newspaper filling screen. Flip down a paper, dolly back to reveal. It's telling you what's happening in the shot. It tells you then the type of shot. Now, all of the stuff that we talked about, extreme close-up, medium length, medium close-up, okay, and so on and so on. And then at the end, because it is television, the lenses have already been chosen, okay? This makes sense? So this is the shot list.
Mr. Khan, could you zoom it up a bit? It's a little less.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah.
Less than visible.
ECU on newspaper filling screen on flip down. Of
paper. Is that better?
Yeah. So if you have to not. Shot of H, A, B, C, D, F, G.
Now, also, guys, so you can see, right?
Mm-hmm.
Gives you the description, it gives you the type of shot, right? The focal, the frame size. Gives you the lens. Come back. I want to also point out this really quickly. Do you guys know about, have you talked about slating? How you slate?
No.
Proper slating? Okay, let me go over this real quick. So anyway, are there any questions on this? I mean, I uploaded this document to Dropbox, not so. So you have it, okay? And I'll actually give you a.
Юу гэдэг зургуудаас яг да ийм 1 2 дугаар шат ингэж авна. Ийм миллиметрээр ямар ийм миллиметр одоо лентэй ямар авна. Тэгээд юу ч юм бас нэг тайлбар нэштэй ингэж явна, тгийж явна, ингэж татна, ингэж явна. Нөгөө фрейзинг мөрний юуас ингэж харна те. Эсвэл яаж ч гэмээ.
Одоо жишээ одоо энэ байгаа дурангийн хэмжээ бол яг стандарт кино камер. Одоо рефлекс болон айлекс инновашн ч юм уу. Энд камерүүдээр байдаг дурангийн хэмжээ. Одоо одоо ингэ Монголын нөхцөл дээр байгаа бол одоо жишээ гараад ямар камер зураг авах вэ? Canon юм уу? 600 юм уу? 700 юм уу? Энэ камерүүдээр зураг авч гэх юм бол энэ камерын үлэмжтэй. Тэгэхээр ерөөд яг ийм байдалтай байна. Зүгээр энгийн Canon-ы дурангууд байгаа шүү дээ. 18-55, 24 даа. Хамгийн 18-аас 24 хүртэл хэмжээ option бол аа.
Wide shot гэсэн үг шүү дээ.
18-аас 24. 18-аас 45 хүртэл.
За 18-аас 45.
45. Тэгээд 45-аас дахлын хооронд юм шиг байна.
Medium shot.
Medium балан ихэрч одоо шүү дээ. Энэс цэцгийн дэш орч байгаа. Option балан ихэр одоо ингээд таг
зүгд бий орч тий.
Энэ бол 18-аас Canon-ы дурвар 18-аас 24 хэмжээ авч байна.
Аа.
Ахрын гол одоогийн бүрийн средний ийм средний ийм группний эсвэл гарны деталь ийм шахсан балануудтай 72 төгснө үү болж байна.
Аа.
А хэрвээ яг 72 төгсдөг дурвар бол Canon дээр мэрэгжлийн дурвар болж байгаа юм. Ахрын гол та нар яг зөвөр энгийн хүчтэй бол а 45-аас дээш зөвөр нэг дурвар 18-135 тэг тэг гээд аюу олон тавтай дурвар дээр чтэй.
хам дурангийн хэмжээг авч
байгаа. Өөр ингээд зум хийж болдог
тийм хаашаа.
Тэгээд чирүүгээр бол яаж болно шүү дээ.
Хана 50-с дэшегээр иллюзитер явсан дурангаар инкрутний талаар хийж байгаа. Сэрэг дуран. Шоссоо 24 гэсэн талаар дээр офшир болно. Тэгвэл дурангийн хэсгээр зүйл байдлаар харж байгаа юм шиг юм.
За, аа зөв тийм тэрийг нэрээ шүү дээ тийм. Окей. Окей.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
We all good? Okay. Yeah. Oh, I don't have it here. Okay. When you slay, just you know what? Let me skip it. You know what? I'll do not so. I'll just put. I'll send you something on slating. I'll send you a little document that explains it. Because I don't have the visual here. So anyway. That's fine. So that there we have our shot list, right? And basically. This list is what we need to do the coverage of the scene, right? We get all these shots, we've covered the entire scene from beginning to end, and now we have the, you know, the options of how we will edit it together in the post-production, okay? So there's that. Okay. So since we're talking about editing, and that sort of thing, would it be okay if I did the, we talked about working with a director and a DP?
Mm-hmm.
We do that now?
Yeah, sure. So we have lunch at... We have lunch in 25 minutes.
25? Okay, no. That's perfect. That's perfect. Okay.
30 minutes? Yeah. So I think we can squeeze in the...
Yeah, let's do that. That'll work out perfectly. Okay. All right. So I am now the master of Hangouts, so I will make this work.
Yep.
Okay. Okay. Do you see working with editors and cinematographers?
Yes, we do.
Yay! This is just too good. Okay. Okay. Now something's. Okay. All right. Let's start with editors. Okay. Okay. First of all, I asked several of my colleagues what they thought, and I wanted to talk with people who I respect and who've done a lot of film editing, and I think that they came up with some very interesting. And important, points, and they all seem to share the same point of view. First thing that's important, I mean, basically, in terms of working effectively with an editor, is that it all begins with the footage, okay? An editor cannot edit bad, you know, he can't make bad footage into good footage, right? He can't make a scene work if the footage isn't there, okay? So first of all, make sure that you get all the coverage you need, okay? Now, when you're working with time constraints and you're working with lower budgets, you know, you may not be able to shoot a million different angles, but if you think about the basic things we've talked about today, it should prepare you to get at least the basic coverage, enough for it to shoot, for it to cut together, okay? I was working with some young filmmakers at Relativity Studios, and I'll give you an example. It was a scene that was in a diner. It was four kids talking, and one of them joined the army, and the others don't want him to go, but he's very gung-ho. He's very enthusiastic about joining. So we started with a wide shot. It was a very wide, you know, shot like we talked about, and he did that for the whole scene, and then he shot singles on everybody. And then he wanted to stop shooting. And I said, no, you have to shoot two shots because it was two people sitting on either side of the booth. I said, it's not going to work if you cut back and forth between medium to tight close-ups and long shots. It's going to look silly. And he said, no, it'll look fine. And then I said, I'm the teacher. Shoot two shots, okay? And so he did. And then obviously when he got into the editing room, would he cut back and forth between was the close-ups and the two shots, okay? So when you not only pre-visualize, you come up with the boards and all that, you have to think in terms of getting all of the coverage that you need to give the editor to put the scene together. Okay? Make sure there are no major errors in continuity. Okay? Do you guys know what that means? Do you know what that continuity means in movies? Okay. It means... Let me give you a simple example. Let's say that we're shooting a scene, and I'm drinking a glass of water, okay? And in every single take of the scene, in every single angle, I pick up the water with my left hand and I put it down with my left hand. But in one of the scenes, in one of the takes, I pick up the water with my right hand, okay? Well, now we have footage that will not match, okay? If I try to edit in the footage of, you know, the actor drinking the water with his right hand, it will not match with everything else. It'll look like the water glass jumped from his left hand to his right hand. Get it? So that's what we call a continuity error. There are continuity errors, guys, in almost every major film. Okay, the audience doesn't usually catch them, but they're there because they're, you know, because it's not perfect. Even Batman, you know, has continuity errors. Okay, so if there are error, there's a position in films which is called the script supervisor, and it's the script supervisor's job to watch every take and make sure things like the coffee cup being in the right hand or whatever, make sure that those kinds of mistakes aren't made. Because if you make mistakes in continuity, then the film will not edit together. The scene will not edit together. Okay? Leave room at the head and tail of the shot. What that means is this, right? So you call action, okay, and you do the whole scene. What a lot of directors will do, let's say the last line in the scene is, I'll see you later, okay? So, okay, Natsu, are you there?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, when I say go, I want you to say that line. Ready? Go. I can't hear you. Okay. Yeah, come closer. Your line is, I'll see you later. Okay, you ready? There you go. Okay. All right, come on, it's your big acting debut. Don't blow it. All right. All right, you ready? Say the line.
Okay,
Hey, I'll see you later.
Cut.
Cut. Okay. If I say cut right on top of the line, right, then there's no room to edit at the end of the shot. Do you see what I'm saying? So this is bad. I'll see you later. Cut. That's bad. I'll see you later. And then you wait. You don't have to wait forever, but give it 5 seconds, 10 seconds, right? Especially if the actor is having a good moment, let it go, okay? Because then the editor can find the right place to cut. He can find the right rhythm. But if you don't leave him any room at the tail of the shot, then he can't edit. Then he there's no choice to be made because you haven't given him any room. Does that make sense, guys?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. It's very important to get matching shots, as we talked about, right? If you shoot an over the shoulder on the one character, you have to shoot an over the shoulder on the other. If you shoot a clean single on one, you got to shoot a clean single on the other. Okay? So you have to be sure that the shots will match. Okay? Also, you have to match for movement. Okay? For instance, if you have a character who's sitting on a couch, okay, and he gets up and he walks to the other end of the room and he, you know, picks up a book, then you have to be sure that, first of all, he can't just magically appear on the other side of the room. You have to shoot him walking across, okay? Now, you may cut, he starts to move, and then you may cut to him getting to his destination, okay? That's fine. But the shots at either end, they have to match, okay? If you have shots that don't match, and a lot of times non-matching shots are product of a, it's because there's an error in continuity, then the editor can't help you, and it's not the editor's fault. Okay? Understand the key dramatic moments in the scene. So what that means is, you know, you have to be able to communicate with your editor. You have to say, look, there's a moment in the scene where the guy breaks down in tears, or he gets very angry, or, you know, he breaks the glasses. You need to tell him that that's an important moment, and you need to maybe say, I need more coverage, I need more time here. I need you to let this moment go on longer. Okay? So you as the director have to know what in the scene are you going to highlight? What in the scene is the most important? Okay? And make sure that the editor understands that and that you guys are kind of on the same page, that you're working together. Okay? Account for continuity of movement. Okay? So that's kind of what I was talking about earlier with matching shots, right? If somebody is, if somebody is getting into a car and you're cutting from the exterior of him getting in to the interior of him, you know, getting behind the driver's seat, right, there has to be continuity of movement, right? So it looks like when you cut, it looks natural. It doesn't look like there's a chunk missing, right, or that the movement is somehow a piece of it's not there, okay? So you have to account for that when you shoot, okay? This is a little bit more about what we talked about, the line, right? So you see where A and B is? So if you're shooting A over the right shoulder, you're shooting B over the left shoulder, and you're going back and forth between those, you can't suddenly move your camera, right? Okay, you can't either move your camera, you can't all of a sudden, you know, have this be a new angle. It can be confusing. And if the A camera, you see the position of the A camera, the answer shot has to be where the B camera is without the X. If the answer shot is where the B camera is with the X, then it doesn't work on the line. Okay, so there has to be continuity of camera. Okay? Okay. Let's just talk a little bit about the key points in the editing process, okay? Now, again, you guys probably won't go through all of these steps just because your projects are smaller and you're working on them together and all that. But let's look at, you know, the key steps if you were editing a feature film, what they would be, okay? So the first part, and this is just now the editor's work, okay? The editor and the assistant editor do what's called logging, which means they get the footage, they organize it according to scene, according to shot, according to take. They keep a record of everything. That's why we do a slate, right? So when we get into the editing room, the editors can look at the slate and know what scene it is, and they know what camera angle it is, and they can keep track of the scenes. Because when you think about it, even in a 5-minute film, you know, let's say you have 50 camera shots in your 5-minute film, and you have 3 takes of each. Well, that's 150 shots now to organize, okay? So the first thing you have to do before you start to edit is to log in. And that's, editors, by the way, are trained to do this, okay? The next thing you do is what we call the first assembly, which is basically putting the project together, okay? That shows the basic continuity of each scene, right? Then we do what we call the rough cut, which is the first. Now, also, it depends on the director, okay? There are some directors who will just let the editor do their assembly and their first rough cut on their own. There are some directors who will sit in the editing room at every moment with the editor, working with him. Martin Scorsese sits with the editor the entire time, okay? But basically, the first thing you want to come up with is what we call a rough cut of the film, which means that it's going to need refinement. But it basically, now we're ordering the shots, right? We're kind of going according to our storyboards. we're ordering the shots the way that we want. We're getting a sense of where the best dramatic moments are. We're putting in the best takes for the actors, right? And we're giving a rough overall cut of the film, okay? The next thing, then we do variations on the rough cut. The director will give notes, maybe the producer will give notes, and then they'll try to go at it again and try to keep refining it, okay? And usually, by the way, the rough cut is usually long. You know, the first cut of a two-hour movie, the two-hour movie you see in a movie theater, I know a lot of movies where the rough cut was 3.5 hours long or 4 hours long, right? But what they want to do with the rough cut is just be sure they're telling their story. Make sure the story makes sense. Make sure it flows together, knowing that they're going to have to go back and cut it and refine it, okay? Next is what we call the first cut, okay? This is moving more toward what would be the final version. So now we're beginning to trim, you know, excess scenes. We're beginning to try to tighten up. I mean, Martin Scorsese will literally go through the movie frame by frame, right? He will, in his final edit, he will cut 3 or 4 frames out of a scene, right? That's 24 frames per second. But his eye is so refined, he will cut a scene by 1/4 of a second, and it makes a difference to him, right? It makes a difference to the rhythm of the scene, okay? So we do the first cut. Then what we do is what we call the fine cut, okay? Usually what you're looking to do at a certain point is what we call lock picture. You get to a point where the visual aspect of the film, the actual visual editing is set, right? All the scenes you want are in, the timings are in, the cuts are in, and it's down to exactly the way you want it to look, okay? Because you can't go on to the next steps until you've locked the picture. Basically, you're saying, this is the visual aspect of the movie. This is how it's going to look and cut together. Now, that said, on bigger projects, a lot of times, filmmakers will do a test screening, or they'll do what we call a focus group, which most film directors hate. And they may get some ideas about how the audience is responding. And then they may go back and they may make some edits again. But there comes a point, at some point, where the picture has to be locked, okay? Then we have what we call our final cut. So after the picture is locked, then we add in music, we add in sound effects, we clean up any sound issues, special effects are layered in, all of that kind of stuff, okay? And that takes us to the final cut of the movie that we'll show to the audience. But we can't get to the final cut until we have a locked picture. Okay? So in your editing process, guys, there comes a point where you've got to say, okay, the visual component of the film is done. We've edited the film. Now we go and we add these other things. Okay? All right. Working with the cinematographer. Cinematographer is also referred to as the director of photography. In America, we usually abbreviate that and we usually say DP, right? So if somebody says, who's your DP, that means who is your director of photography, who's your cinematographer, okay? Okay? All right. The DP's main job is to execute the vision of the director, okay? Now, a great director of photography will have his own visual ideas, right? And the collaboration between the director of photography and the director, if it's a good one, can make the film much, much better, okay? But you have to realize that everybody is there to serve the vision of the director, okay? The designers, the actors, everybody. So the DP's main job is to make sure that what the director wants is executed on film. But he's the person who has the technical knowledge, so to speak, of camera, of lighting, and so forth, of how to do this. Okay. Generally speaking, the DP will choose the camera, lenses, and lighting equipment. Okay. I have a friend who made an independent film about a year ago. And he had meetings with the DP, before they ended up choosing their camera and all that. The director of photography liked the Arri Alexa and felt it was the best choice for the film. I think they did some tests with the Sony Red Epic and the Alexa, maybe one other. Then they finally went and chose the Alexa, which was the DP's first choice. Okay, so you know, you really do want to defer if you're going to hire a DP that you trust. I think you want to defer to their judgment. At least I do. Okay, and again, he will be the one to, you know, execute with lighting and with lenses what's going to appear in the frame to please the director. The DP also hires the camera crew, means the first assistant director, the second assistant director, and all the people who work with him on the camera crew. That includes grips, electric, all those people are considered part of the camera crew. Okay. The DP supervises the crew for lighting and camera placement. So the DP is going to tell the crew where to put the lights, what size and intensity to use. You know, he'll work with the director in terms of color and all that, but the director is really the person who is doing the hands-on supervising of getting the camera in place, getting the lighting equipment in place, and so forth. Okay, that's his area of expertise. Okay. Some tips for working with your DP: collaborate. Okay, the better, you know, again, as a director, you have the final say. And as a director, you should know what you want. It's very important to be clear and to have a vision about how you want things to look. But at the same time, collaborate. Listen, you know, pay attention. Your DP and your editor will probably have really, really good ideas, and you're silly not to listen to them. Okay? Okay. I've talked to cinematographers, and if you as the director or director-writer have a passion for the story that you're telling, that means a lot to a cinematographer. They want to help create something that's artistic and beautiful. And if you communicate to them that you have a real passion for the story, I think that that really helps get them involved and make them feel like they're making a real creative contribution. Okay? Generate a storyboard and shot list. Okay? It may change. You may collaborate with the DP on this in pre-production. Okay, you know, all I can tell you guys is this: go in prepared. Okay, if things change on the day where you say, "Oh, I have a better idea, let's shoot that," that's fine. But go in as prepared as you can possibly be, and that means having a storyboard and a shot list. Okay. Okay, this is very important too. The director needs to have an overall visual style for the film. How do you really want your film to look overall? Okay, and there's not only do you have to be able to communicate this to the DP, but you have to be able to communicate this to your production design, right? Your production designer and your art department. Okay, so here are some things that you can use. You can use paintings and photographs, right? If it's a period piece, or if it's inspired, if the look you have is inspired by a certain artist that you love, right? You know, make a book of paintings and photographs that you can show the DP, right, to give him an idea of the way you see it, okay? There's a Woody Allen film called Stardust Memories, which is a really good movie. It's one of his more underrated films. Yeah.
Sorry. We almost can't see the slide. It's a little blurry, and the font is a little small.
Okay, hold on. Let me see if I can fix that. Just give me a moment.
Sure. Watch that. I'm not too soon. А дождь-то. Так, PowerPoint. Collaborate to join ихнийхэн love. Have a passion for the story гэж ягш байна. Generate the storyboard.
All right. Let me
хаан доороос хамгийн доотлих нь уу? Урт нь generate a storyboard and shot list. In pre-production, одоо өнөөдөр та нар хийх ажил шүү дээ. Shot list, storyboard, тий?
Hold on. I will try not to destroy your eyeballs here. Okay, give me one sec. I'll adjust this.
Mr. Khan, we have, so the teams want to ask what kind of, you know, vision they want to maintain during the production. I think they want to ask, like, briefly, you know,
okay,
two questions right after this lecture and right before the launch.
Sure. Let me just fix this a little bit here. We'll get right back to it. Okay. Okay. I don't know what you're looking at now.
We can see it pretty better.
Oh, okay. You could see all those little adjustments I was making? Okay.
Yeah. Paintings, photographs, architecture.
Okay. Okay. So, yeah. So, the idea is to, you know, really try to give a unified look to your film, right? You want it to feel cohesive visually, okay? So part of this, again, is working with your production designer, but it's also really important that the cinematographer, you communicate this to him as well, because he's going to be shooting a color palette, you know, with the lights and all that. So paintings, photographs, architecture, and don't be afraid to use other films, right? You can pull stills from other films that have the design aspect you want or the color scheme that you want, but you have to have an overall sense, a visual sense for the film, okay? And then finally, the other thing that's helpful is, you know, at least last couple of things, you know, understand if you're what are the basic ideas, the basic conventions of the genre of your film, right? Like if you're making a detective film, right? You don't have to do it exactly the way everybody else has. You do your own thing, but understand, like, what are some of the basics about character in that film? What are some of the basics about visual style, right? What are some of the basics about lighting, right? And to have a solid knowledge of film genre can help you kind of spin it out and make it your own. But you do have to communicate, again, what you need to work through with your cinematographer is a unified visual style, okay? So some things that are helpful to understand, it's really good to understand basic lighting as a director, okay? I mean, I don't really want to go into this too much now. We can maybe come back to it, but, you know, understand the difference between hard and soft light, understand the difference between high and low key lighting, understand the difference between high contrast and low contrast, understand basic camera concepts, understand depth of field, understand, basic, you know, you don't have to know as much as the DP, but understand basic lenses, okay? And again, I think you have to be very clear on what you need in every shot, but you don't have to tell, you don't have to be over the DP's shoulder telling him what to do at every second. If he knows his job, he will do it for you, and he will deliver what you want, okay? You just have to be clear on what it is you need. And I will tell you that some DPs get frustrated where a director is not clear, where they give the DP a vague idea of what they might want in a scene. So a DP goes off and he spends 3 or 4 hours lighting the space and lighting the scene, and the director comes back and goes, no, that's really not what I wanted. Well, if the director didn't, if the DP didn't do what you asked him, that's one thing. But if you didn't give him clear instructions, if you didn't communicate clearly what you were looking for, then it's not his fault that he doesn't give you something you're happy with. Okay. So again, it's about being clear, and it's about being, you know, prepared, and it's also about, to me, having worked as a director in the theater for many years, worked as an actor, it's about, you know, having an open mind and listen and having good collaboration. Okay. So, I mean, I think, you know, these are the basic understandings, I think, of what a director needs to do to work with the, you know, the most important people in your crew are the cinematographer and the editor, because these are the people who are going to make or break the film, you know? Mm-hmm. Anyway, so there's that. Now we'll go back. Hold on, guys. All right. Oh, that's kind of strange.
We have another infinity.
Wow. That was my special effect for you. I hope you like it.
Thank you.
Wow. It's called Infinity into Mongolia. And yeah, it's going to be great.
Way better than Transformers.
Yes, exactly. Let's try this again. There we go. So were there specific questions?
Yeah. За асуулт удаа танаар сайхан. Нэг нь баг ойртож ирээд яачуд яасан. Би эсвэл ингэж яваад тах.
By the way, you'll notice I'm way too low in the frame, right?
Oh. It's the no battery crash. Aha. Footage гэж юу юм бэ гэж юу? So she's asking over there, what's a footage?
Footage? Oh, that means footage means the actual film that you shoot, okay? We call the film that you shoot footage, because it used to be that in an old camera, you know, you had feet of film. It was measured in feet.
Okay. Өөр асуулт. Суу киноныхаа санаа манаатай холбоотой ч юм уу эсвэл өөр асуулт. Тавтууд бол ерөнхий юм байна. Гэхдээ өнөөдөр бол танаа киноныхаа дээр найруулгатай холбоотой юм уу гэж асууж байгаа шүү дээ. Okay, they're thinking.
Sure.
You? Think they're so. Come over here. She's going to ask.
Okay. Hello, Mr. Khan.
Hi, how are you?
Hi there.
Hi there.
We have a story about two. About a couple who are mute and they're hiding each other and little I mean
they're having an argument.
Fighting. And the story, the main message is that people cannot connect just only their language or talking, and they're connected by their soul, by their hearts. The main message.
Yeah, that's great.
But the story is not so fit with that. I think it's not suitable with the meaning. How you think about this?
I think what you have to do is think about the plot. Do you know what I mean? The plot. The plot means what do the characters do? What happens in the story? Okay? And don't worry so much anymore about your theme, right? Your overall idea that you told me, because that's going to be in your movie. That's what you want your movie to be about, right? That's what the heart of the movie is, okay? So now you have to figure out at every moment what are the characters doing? Right. In other words, does the guy come in and she puts food in front of him and he tastes it and he doesn't like it. Right. I'm just making it up. But what you have to write are the what we call the beats of the story, the specific things that each character does. Right. In the story. Now, the easiest way to do this. Right. Here's the trick that makes it easier. You say, what does the character want in the story, right? what does the one character want from the other? And everything he does or everything she does should help him get what he wants from the other person. That makes sense? So
yes.
You need to, so right now, because you have a good overall idea, right, big idea, now you have to think about the little ideas. Like, what are the little things that happen in the movie, one by one, that tell the story, okay? And that's what we call the plot, right? So if you write out a plot and send it to me, I'll look at it.
Okay?
Don't worry.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Scott.
It's the hard part. Okay. I'm sorry, hang on one sec. Oh. Anybody else have a question?
I want to ask a question. We have a story about a man who can't remember. He woke up in the hospital.
Yeah.
And this story kind of very dark, and we want to do it maybe not too criminal, but with some kind of happy end or this because it's a big. It's like an interrogator, and he's when the criminal. He everything about the things that he's killer, and maybe we want to add some that he has a girlfriend or some wife and a woman.
Okay.
This film.
But he has a girlfriend. He has a girlfriend.
And, yes, and a girlfriend. And like she feels you know,
you do a little rich no one, half stuck to the half jealous.
She will jealous about this guy, and also we have some elements that this guy at his previous life when he didn't remember, he was beaten up with the other guy.
Okay.
This was a big thing, and two guys were beaten, but he was very outraged and scared at the same time, and he knifed the man who was with him, and before the man died, he beat him again, and then one of them died, but he is still alive, and he then woke up at the hospital, and okay. Interrogator asks him, who is this man, do you know, and he said, here's the passport details, and you, why don't you say that you are a killer, actually, and he said, I really don't know. And the action goes when he's asking him, it's like psychological drama, if he is killer or not.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, there is a woman from this previous life. He don't know. He doesn't know about her, but this is. Moment maybe And we don't know how to continue this end, how to end. Don't need to be too dark and criminal.
So, okay, so you wanted, how do you want, let's jump to the end. How do you want the story to end? What do you want our man to, do you want him to remember what happened? How do you want it to end?
And our team member said that he will remember it in one time, instantly, all together, all will he remember.
Mm-hmm.
And after he's remember, it will be like
you remember it. What's that thing there? What's that?
Тэгээ санчаад нэг бодлон гэсэн.
Гүү саналаа гэж байсан чинь гэн толгой хүн болсон байж таараад тэ. Тэгээд юу нь болохоор
нөхөний эмгтэн хүн оруулсан шүү дээ.
Эмгтэн хүн оруулсан юм.
Оруулсан шүү дээ.
Тийм өөрөө гэрчлэгч байсан л даа. Та нар өөрсдөө зөвхөн
амжаа. They haven't read their own story. I read their script. So apparently, so the cop guy keeps like pushing him, like accusing him of a murder.
Right.
Very attractive looking witness who just plain out points him out to be the murderer. But then when the murderer confesses, it turned out he was not the murderer all along. Something like that? Because he was like left
hand up. Yeah, I think so. But the way I thought it was like, how do I say it? I thought like we could like make it into a very artsy or underground film, but. When a guy remembers everything, like when he came back from the amnesia, he'll remember everything. But like, so I thought like we can like not show the flashback, so that way like we can save time and we don't have to like shoot the scenes at different places and make it easier to like not shoot all the very like killing scenes and everything. So. I thought the guy will remember everything when he looks at one of the pictures, and then he'll just tell the police officer that he just remembered everything, and then they got into a fight when they got out from the bar, and he hit the guy in the head with a brick when he. To protect himself from him, and then after he hit him. He hit him back in the head, but the other guy died, and the other guy didn't, and so we'll just make him say that. That way, but we won't show any flashbacks. So that way, the police officer and the audience will all be not sure if the guy is telling the truth or not. I thought that would be a very interesting way to
end. Sure. I mean, you're thinking sort of. You know, how can you tell it as economically as you can? I would suggest maybe put a couple of flashbacks in there, even if they're really brief, you know, because you could still have it be at the end if you want to leave it unclear that he killed him or he didn't kill him. That's fine. But I think just to have them talk about it, you know, in movies we need to see it. You know, we need to see it on screen generally versus just talking about it because it happened before. So, you know, maybe there's a way to get just enough flashbacks in there so it can get the audience's interest. You know, they're going to go, oh, well, what really did happen? Or, you know, you show them little bits of memory, you know, and then you can have your character put them together. But I think otherwise it's just going to be the two of them having a conversation. And how does your main character realize... You know what I'm saying? How does he get his memory back? What makes him remember?
I thought that maybe his amnesia could be only temporary.
Yes.
So when the police officer shows him the pictures of the evidence, he'll look at the brick or the knife that he killed the person with, and he'll immediately get back his memories and then just confess it. But the police would be so confused that he just might have been faking it, that he has amnesia for the whole time, and when he comes near that he'd be caught, he just made some story up.
That could work. That could work. And then think about what's the reversal at the end. I mean, maybe there's one piece of everything that he doesn't remember until the very end of the movie that changes everything, you know? Remember we talked about the reveal and the reversal in your third act? Maybe there's one thing that he doesn't remember till almost or the very end or the very end that changes the whole story, you know?
Mm-hmm. You know? Okay. So I think we're running out of time, so I think let's wrap it up.
Okay.
Let's finish it now. Thank you, Mr. Khan. Thank you for our teacher for our 2 days of very, very hard work. It's almost midnight over there.
That's 9:30 here. Yeah, it's not too late.
Okay, but it's very late where you are, and we really appreciate your help. We will do тавтгуудэр дахиад нөгөө өглөө бас та нарт ерөнхий нөө санал асуулт хариултыг юу явуулна. On Friday we'll do a very very short Q&A session, right?
Okay, absolutely. I'd be happy to.
And then the teams will show you how much of a good great film they made.
Sure will be.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So thank you very much, Mr. Khan, again.
Everybody, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you guys. Thank you.
So
you're not going to sing over the rainbow? I'm just kidding.
We'll sing something else on Friday. Okay.
All right. Okay. We'll talk tomorrow. So thank you, everybody. It's been great fun. Thank you.
Okay. So goodbye, Mr. Khan. Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Good night. Okay. Yeah.